Bismillah walhamdulillah. My dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is your brother Abdus Salam, and welcome to this new in between talks talk. I have decided to start a series called The False Claims in Allah's Religion in Islam, the false Islam, so to speak. And in this series, where I will discuss certain elements of what is formed as an essential belief when in fact it is not. One of such beliefs is about the seven categories of people that is said will be shaded on Judgment Day, when there is no other shade except that of Allah. What I would like to say as I progress in this talk here and subsequent ones, please, yes, it's good to have an information and be educated about these things, but also it would be great if you can learn the thinking process, how I reach what I reach, and so that it helps you when you come across some kind of form of belief or someone preaches something to you, how you can evaluate it, how you can run it through the Quran to ensure that what you are getting is from Allah and not from humans. The other thing that I would like to mention is that I have kittens at home. I have got like 7 or 8 of them, and kittens do not understand sit. So if you hear bumps here and something like that, it is just them kittens doing what they should be doing, learning about to lead a life. Now back to the seven categories of people that will be shaded on Judgment Day, when there is no other shade except that of Allah. If you have been a Muslim for any length of time, you might have heard that on Judgment Day, the sun will draw so near to humans. Actually, it is mentioned on couple hadith narratives that they either come at an arm length or about a mile. Not very far, like it's 1.5 kilometers. So it's not very far from the heads of people. And as a consequence to this nearness, people would sweat heavily or lightly depending on their actions. So the good doers will sweat little or none, and as such, they won't drown in their sweating, and while the heavy sinners will sweat till they are drowned in their own sweat. And of course, so much has been said about this hadith narrative, and the whole thing about this is absolutely a hoax, a lie. It can't take place, and as you will see in the evidences provided in the Quran. When the Quran doesn't speak at all, this kind of nonsense will prevail, will become a religion, and is preached and written about, and people are scared about it, even though people really don't care about it. But hey, the sheikhs would love it that people get scared. But as soon as you bring the Quran in, then everything falls apart. We're gonna see first what the men of religion say and preach, and what people believe in and repeat and preach. And on Jum'ah you hear this, or Friday you hear this, the sheikhs giving this kind of talks. And then we will decorticate, we will analyze, we will give an autopsy to this hadith narrative, and slowly by slowly you will see why it is such a huge lie. I call it the human made up hadith narratives, because I, as you know, do not believe at all in anything apart from the Quran. And I have in the Quran what is sufficient for me to enter Jannah. I don't need anything else, really, 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 really. But let's go about what is preached out there. The hadith has been reported through different variety of different people, and we'll get back to that. But the hadith that I'm going to mention now is reported by Al-Bukhari and Muslim. And as you know, once the hadith is reported by Bukhari and Muslim, it becomes stronger than the Quran itself. And that's why the Salafis, they say, if a hadith is authentic, i.e. Bukhari and Muslim, and the Quran doesn't agree with that hadith, priority is given to the hadith. And it's sad as it is, but that's how they said. So I will go just straight away into the English translations. I will not mention the Arabic version, since this is an English talk. The hadith narrative states, there are seven under Allah's shade, when there is no other shade except that of Allah. So there are seven categories whom Allah will shade in His shade on the day when there is no shade except Allah's. Meaning on Judgment Day, as the sun shall rise and it will scorch everything, it will heat everything, like in a desert and you don't have a single tree or rock. So as you can see how the sun is heating right in that desert. So they say only there is one exception, there is a shade, and that shade is of Allah. And then if you fulfill one of the seven categories here that I'm going to mention, then you are entitled to be hidden and kept safe in that shade. The first one is a just ruler. A governor, a king, ruler. I'll get in details about these things. Number two, a youth who grew up in the worship of his Lord. And number three, a man whose heart is attached to the mosques, to the masjids. Number four, two men who love each other for Allah's sake. They meet upon that and they part upon that. They love each other, they met, they fall in love with each other for the sake of Allah and disperse for with that love. Number five, a man who is invited by a woman of beauty and attraction, of course, for illegal sex. But he says, I fear Allah. Sorry, I fear Allah. Number six, a man who gives in charity. He makes a donation and hides it, so much so that his left hand doesn't know what his right hand has spent, has given. And number seven, a man who remembers Allah in private and shed tears because of that. So according to this hadith narrative, if you are one of these people, then you are entitled to that shade. Of course, the men of religion have debated this narrative, and I'm going to now present you with what they said, because it's interesting, and we will see later on why what they say and all what I just told you until now is just a plain hoax and a lie. They say for the number seven, sab'atun, seven categories that Allah shall, they say the number seven, even though the hadith narrative here about Bukhari and Muslim and Ahmad and is authentic and all that kind of stuff, they said even though the number seven is mentioned here, but there are other categories that have been mentioned and are not mentioned in this hadith. What they're saying is there are other hadith narratives that have mentioned other categories. So if we add the other categories to this number seven, the number would increase 8, 9, 10, 11 and so on and so forth. And here are a couple of these hadith narratives that are on top of the already mentioned seven. Muslim, the one who mentioned the hadith of seven are shaded, adds another hadith. If someone who is owed money makes it easy for the person in debt, he will be shaded in Allah's shade when there is no shade except Allah's. So now we have a number eight in another hadith also by Ahmed, who is the teacher of Muslim. The hadith states that each person is in the shade of his or their charity on the day when Allah will rule on other people, and this person will stay in their shade until Allah brings them to accountability. So here we are now at to number nine. There are other narratives, but enough of this. So the number seven itself no longer holds. When we look at the man who delays taking money from someone indebted, the sheikhs and the scholars, the men of religion, say that either the man completely forgives and says to the other person, do not return my money, or delays. If you can't return it now, I will allow it, you know, kind of like, yeah, 2, 3 years, whatever, months, whatever. So if these people do not make it hard on people, then they will be shaded in the shade of, there is no shade except the shade of Allah. The men of religion say, to truly appreciate the shade and being under the shade, you will need to think about the bigger picture on judgment day. A, the very low position of the sun. So the sun is extremely, extremely like an arm length above your head. I don't know how they have pictured this. They thought maybe the sun is like a soccer ball, a football. The ball itself, like you can put it on top of your head. The sun is huge. How can it be on top of a human's head? But anyhow, they say the sun will be very low, and that's why it'll be extremely hot. They also say judgment day will be extremely hot. Why? The huge number of people and the jinn and the angels, everybody is gathered on judgment day, on the hashar, on the gathering place. And the way they breathe, the physical contact, the sun on top, you can imagine the heat. And the third thing that's going to make the judgment day extremely hot, they say, is hellfire will be brought. and it shall be dragged by a huge number of angels. They depicted hellfire. They gave this mental picture of hellfire as a big, like a big plastic container, like a huge container, and it has 70,000 hooks. Each of these hooks, there is a hook and like a rope, and on each rope, it's like the tug of war when two people pull on a rope, like seven from each side, and they pull who wins, who drags the other one to the other line. So this one is hellfire, has 70,000 hooks surrounding it, and then the angels would attach a hook with a rope, and then the angels will be pulling that hellfire. On each line is 70,000 angels. If you do the math, it is 4,900,000,000 angels pulling hellfire. It's incredible. 4,900,000,000 angels. That is an astronomical figure. But this is the price of exaggeration. Why? Because the men of religion want us to believe like the hellfire is extremely gigantic. But the size of it doesn't matter. What Allah told us is enough, that the bad people, Jahannam, shall be more than enough. Allah has mentioned in the Quran, يَوْمَ نَقُولُ لِجَهَنَّمَ هَلِمْ تَلَأْتِ the day we tell hellfire, have you reached your capacity? And it shall say, هَلْ مِنْ مَزِيدٍ, is there any more? So it's more than enough, but enough. The other question that they discussed here is the shade, that shade that is on Judgment Day, is it the shade of Allah? Or is it a shade, or the shade of the throne? Or is it anything altogether different than these two? And you would think a narrative like this, with such a huge importance, that the messenger tells people, and he doesn't tell them what kind of shade this would be. And you would think like a narrative like this would clearly and cleanly mention what it? No, you'd be wrong. There is actually the men of religion discussed and disputed this topic, and they ended up with three different major opinions. Three different sheikhs or scholars, whatever they want to name themselves, they meet and they talk about it, and one of them is going to say, oh, I believe it's the shade of Allah. The other one, they say, no, it's the shade of the throne of Allah. And the third one will come, no, it's neither Allah nor his throne. It will be a completely different shade altogether. So, those who say it's the shade of the throne of Allah bring in a hadith and some hadith narratives, others, where it says Allah will shade seven in the shade of his arsh, of his throne, on Judgment Day. That's it. They say the hadith is authentic. In Sunan Ibn Sa'id Ibn Mansur, this is a hadith collector as well, with a good chain of narrators, and that should be more than enough. They even bring other hadiths in Muslim, where the hadith reads like this, he who grants a respite to a man for wealth and things like that, because that man is in difficulties and things like that, Allah shall shade him with his shade. They say, that's it, it's the shade of Allah. Another one comes in and said, no. At-Tirmidhi mentioned, and others have authenticated this hadith and classified it as sahih, authentic, good, and one of such people is Al-Albani. They tell you, he who grants a respite, and then they tell you the hadith, in the shade of the throne of Allah. So we have, and then comes the third point of view, is that like Ibn Uthaymeen or Saudi Arabia and a few other sheikhs, they tell you, no. It's not the shade of Allah per se, and it's not the shade of the throne, but it is a completely different shade that Allah will create for the purpose of shielding people from the sun. That's that. So here, and they can't agree on any of them. And to tell you the truth, I have big problems with this. If you tell me of this event, like such the huge event with such magnitude, and then you can't agree on what kind of shade that is, I'm sorry. I can't take it, but we'll get to this. Now, the other problem that also the sheikhs have met, if to have the sun above the head of people, it must be higher than them. And for people, people to be under the shade, the sun has to be above any element. So if it is, if this shade is from the throne of Allah, the sun has to be higher than the throne. And if, as the Salafi doctrine and dogma say, Allah sits on the throne like you would sit on a chair, where would the sun be exactly? When you say it's going to shield people from above the throne, and Allah is seated above the throne, where would the sun be? Would it be higher than Allah? And in which case, when Allah says in the Quran, سَبِّحْ اسْمَ رَبِّكَ الْأَعْلَى, glorify the name of your Lord, the Most High, we all know that Allah is the highest of everything. Nothing is above Allah. So in order for the sun to burn, to be able to create a shade, it has to be above. Alrighty, so since Allah is higher, where would the sun be? So as I said, other people to run away from this problem, they said, no, of course, the understanding that the sun will be higher than the throne of Allah or above Allah is so wrong. This understanding is wrong. Because the shade is something that Allah creates. So now if Allah is going to create this, the sun needs to be above that shade to, oh God Almighty, you can see where this, the whole thing is going. But anyhow, there is other hadith narratives where it says that on day of resurrection, the sun would be brought near to the creation, i.e. jinn, humans and the jinn, till it is only about a mile away from them. And as I said before, there are other hadith narratives, they say only an arm length. If I was there, I would say, yeah, Messenger of Allah, are you sure when Allah revealed this to you, did he say a mile or an arm length? Because on Judgment Day, since the sun is going to draw and be on top of our heads, a mile and an arm length play a big role. About the sun itself, yeah, the hadith narrative clearly states that there will be a sun on Judgment Day as we know it today. And because of this narrative, the Salafi sect and almost all other sects, since they all take from Bukhari and Muslim, things like that, they agree with this explanation that there shall be a sun on Judgment Day, and that that sun will be brought on top of humans and it will cause them to sweat and things like that. But the Quran tells us that there is no sun on Judgment Day. The sun, the moon, the stars, the oceans, the mountains, the deserts, the wilderness, everything that we know of are part of this world and have nothing, absolutely nothing to do on Judgment Day. When Allah wanted us to see that there is other things from this life that will be in Judgment Day, He mentioned them. He mentioned the trees, He mentioned fruits, He mentioned rivers, He mentioned waters. Why did He mention those? Because that is something from this life that will be also created in Judgment Day. And He kept quiet. He really kept quiet about the mountains, volcanoes and things like that, the sun and the moon, especially about the sun and the moon. The Quran is clear about no existence of any sun or the moon on Judgment Day. The sun and the moon are part of the here now, not of the hereafter. As Allah wraps up this world and causes it to end, He made sure to tell us in the Quran and in the Bible and in the books that He descended, the stages that He will take about to clear the world, to finish this world. Firstly, the sun. Where does it reside, my dear sisters and my brothers? It resides in the heaven, in the open space, right? That open space itself, Allah told us, is a thama'un fatarat, when the sky is ruptured. So the thing, this is in Surah 82, the ayah number 1. So the container that contains the stars and the moon and the constellation and earth itself, that container which is the heavens, the skies and things like that, will be ruptured. It will be torn into pieces. So when Allah states in the Quran that the container, which is the heavens, that today contains the heavens and the earth and planets and everything, itself will be ruptured, torn into pieces, the laws which keep the planets together also get broken, get disturbed, that's it, and also get ruptured. And because the container, which is the heavens, no longer exists, everything that exists within that container will fall apart as well. The planets will fall away from the orbits which hold them, and that orbit is in the heaven. That's why Allah says, وَإِذَا الْكَوَاكِبُ انْتَثَرَتْ, and when the planets are scattered, because there'll be no physics, no law of physics or any other law that will hold them together. The sun exists in the heaven, and that's why Allah says, إِذَا الشَّمْسُ كُوِّرَتْ, when the sun is put out. So the sun as we know it today will have no space, no place where it can exist. The heavens with the skies as we know it, the space, the outer space where the sun is today, and the sun is the way it is today is because of the environment in which it exists. Once that environment is destroyed, the sun cannot live. Let me give you an example. I'm gonna take sharks or dolphins. Let's go for dolphins. Dolphins live in an environment. That environment are the oceans, water. If the environment, the water itself is destroyed, the dolphins will die, because the dolphins cannot exist in any other environment except oceans. The same thing for the sun. The sun exists today in space, in outer space. Once the heaven, the space is ruptured, falls apart, planets will fall apart, orbits will fall apart, and the sun will be put out. There is no more energy from the sun. Is this only for the sun? Of course not. For any other planet, including the moon. And this is why Allah says, فَإِذَا النُّجُومُ طُمِسَتْ, when the stars are also put out. Why? Because they get their energy from the sun. Number five, once the outer space gets completely ruptured and there is an imbalance and disharmony there, it will affect the earth. And then Allah goes, وَإِذَا الْجِبَالُ نُسِفَتْ, when the mountains will be suddenly uprooted from their places. Why? Because gravity, everything will go berserk, everything will go out of the normal. Mountains will totally get destroyed and uprooted. So much so that a mount like the Everest, which is almost 9 kilometers in the sky, it's 5.5 miles high, that mount will get blown away as if you have injected thousands upon thousands upon thousands of dynamite sticks and you blew it away from the roots until Mount Everest is rendered to dust. That is the power of the destruction that will occur to this world. This is why Allah reports to us that the disbelievers of Mecca, when they ask the messenger so many questions about what shall happen this and what shall happen that, Allah told him, Ya Muhammad, وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْجِبَالِ, and should they ever ask you about the mountain, this is in the Quran, tell them, my Lord will wipe them out completely, then completely turns them into a leveled plain in a valley, very flat. You will not see in this valley no depression and no elevations, no holes and no elevation. Everything will be flat upon flat. Once the mountain are removed, remember the heavens, the sun, the moon, everything is gone out of the ordinary. Once the mountains have been removed, comes stage number five. The plates, the earth, the geological plates of the earth starts moving and the seismic power of the earth kicks in. And when the earth is no longer stabilized by the mountains, it starts quaking. The earthquakes are, forget the 10 degree Richter, and for it will be beyond, because the earth is about to get completely destroyed. And that is when Allah says, إِذَا زُلْزِلَتِ الْأَرْضُ زِلْزَلَهَا, when the earth has quaked with its ultimate quake, the final earthquake that will witness the demise of the earth. And when the earth earth has thrown out all its contents. Remember, all aspects of physics have changed because the skies, the moon, everything is out of proportion now. The earth will just start vomiting everything that's inside it. It's the upside down, inside out phenomena. And that's why the earth will throw everything that it contains. And when that elements is taking place, the destruction is taking place, humans, as usual, will start questioning, what's wrong? Oh my God, what's happening? Well, because that's how it is. That's how we react to these calamities. And on that day, the earth itself, the rocks, the mountains, and all those, there are no mountains, but the rocks, the trees, the earth itself will speak. And it will start yelling at people, I am the way I am because your Lord has instructed me. And this is in Surah Zalzala 99. In other words, the earth will be subjected to the final quake. And as it goes through the destruction, humans will inquire and the answer will be. Once the earth starts shaking, it's about the end, comes step number 6. When the earth is entirely crushed over and over, it's like you take a mortar, you know, sometimes in the kitchen you want to crush something. And you put them like in a pot made of iron. And then you have a small stick or a bar and you bang on that thing until you crush it, until it becomes like dust. Well, the earth is going to go through the same fate. And it is so amazing how Allah gave us details about how the earth will completely disappear. The earth will be crushed over and over until it becomes dust, because out of dust it came. And that's why Allah, to create a human being, He added water for us to unite all the particles of dust to make one single body. And the earth is exactly the same thing. And just like we disintegrate when we die, the earth will disintegrate as it dies. The earth and all that ever existed upon it, be that humans, jinn, animals, mountains, oceans, you name it, everything shall go extinct. Once that happens, Allah then turns to the skies, as we know them now, and completely wraps up the container that holds the earth, because the earth is turned into dust, the sun into dust, the moon's constellation, everything is turned into dust. And once everything is into dust, the sky, look at the sky, it doesn't have a presence. We can't touch the skies. If you keep going, it's just air upon air, it's just gases. And we go back to that stage. And once that happens, and nothing is of substance to touch, Allah tells us in the Quran, يَوْمَ نَطْوِي السَّمَاءَ كَطَيِّ السِّجِلِّ الْكُتُبِ, the day we roll up the sky, like a scroll rolls up the writings. You know when you write on a scroll of paper, and then when you finish, you roll it up to fold it, and then Allah says, just as we began the first creation, we shall repeat it. Yeah. From dust, Allah added water. From water, He made clay, and then life, and things like that. Now, the process is reversed. And then He says, this is a promise we have made upon ourselves, is that He creates, and then He reverses the process of creation, and then He creates another world based on just how He created the first one. And then He says, and truly we shall uphold. So as you can see, at one point in existence, there was nothing, and then Allah created the heavens, and there were only gas, and from the gas come particles of that gas, and then Allah added water, and then the formation of planets took place, and then Allah said the sun in hot energy, and the earth is calmed and cooled down with waters and everything. So the process is really a reverse. And on part number 8, once Allah has completely destroyed the earth, has completely now destroyed the heavens and folded them up and they don't exist no more, everything goes into extinction. Nothing exists but Allah. And then Allah will start recreation one more time on the day when the earth is changed into another earth, and also are the heavens. So Allah will recreate. And it is clear from here and upward that when Allah shall create another world, it will take place exactly as He did the first creation, and the creation of the new earth will be not far from the one we have today. So that's why Allah states in the Quran that the earth will be exchanged by another earth and the heavens will be exchanged by other heavens. The other reality that Allah established in the Quran is that Judgment Day shall take place in total darkness, except a light that Allah gives to the believers because of their belief, not us only, but to the believers since the day Allah sent Adam as a representative of the humankind until the last man. Any person who believes in Allah and things like that will have a light. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah of Al-Hadid, which is the Surah number 57 from Ayah 12 and 13. I'll just read the English of the meaning, the meanings of the English. On the day when you shall see believers, i.e. the men and women, their light shining forth before their arms. There is a light that comes in front of them. Why is this light necessary if we're gonna have the sun? Well, that light is necessary because we need to see where we're going because it's completely dark. At that moment there, Allah says, that light has been granted to them because of how they believed and how they acted on this earth, and that they will be on their way to the gardens under which rivers flow, i.e. paradise. On the other hand, along with these believers, there is another group of people. That group of people are the hypocrites. And then Allah says, on that day, hypocrite men and women will beg of the believers, wait for us so that we may have some of your light. Because they can't walk, it's completely dark. And then it will be said to them by other angels, of course, mockingly, go back to the world, hey, go back to the world. And seek a light in the world by following the light of the revelation. Remember, the Quran is light. So when you follow the light today, you will have light in the hereafter. If you follow darkness today, you'll be in total darkness in the hereafter. So it's clear that on Judgment Day, there is no light and no shadow. Sorry, there is no sun and there's no, it's complete darkness. So when Allah creates the new earth, Allah said something about that new earth that the sheikhs and men of religion should have paid attention. But as usual, they don't care much about that because their full attention is on the hadith narratives and the Quran is something extra. What Allah says, وَأَشْرَقَتِ الْأَرْضُ بِنُورِ رَبِّهَا, about the new earth that Allah will create, He tells us, and that earth, the newly created earth, will shine with the splendor of the light of its God, of its Lord. And the book of everyone's deed will be placed, and the prophets and the witnesses will be brought forth, because they're going to witness against people, and judgment will be passed on all with fairness. None will be wronged. And this is in Surah 39, Az-Zumar, the Ayah 69. What Allah is telling us is this: the new earth that He will create will not have a sun as we know it, because that earth, the new earth, where Allah will build hellfire and Allah will build the paradise, and where humans will raise and all that, and will be accounted for accountability, the resurrection, everything will be on the new earth. That new earth will only have one source of light, and that is of Allah Himself, and that light is given by Allah to those who sought His light in this world. And it will not be a light like that of the sun, daytime, or when you have a torch in your hand. So my question to these sheikhs and to this hadith and to this narrative, when exactly will this sun be on top of the heads of people? Why? When exactly? They will tell you, oh, it is from the moment you are resurrected, because they tell these stories that when we are resurrected, of course, this story contradicts the Quran 1000%, but that's what they tell. And they say that as soon as we all come out and we are resurrected, we shall all be on earth and we'll be just waiting on Judgment Day to start. So basically, the Quran says when we resurrect, that's it. We start way straight away heading to accountability. Our men of religion, they say no. When we are resurrected, we will wait for 40 years We stand there 40 years waiting on judgment day to occur, and Allah will be completely heedless to us. He will kind of like, I don't care, I will let you there, I will make you suffer. And we just say, yeah, Allah, please, 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 just do the accountability and let us go to hell, but just do it. And they say it is at that moment that the sun will come. But the whole thing, the Quran, the entire Quran says there is no sun on judgment day. The sun will lose its light. And there is even another ayah in the Quran where Allah explicitly says there won't be any sun or moon on judgment day. Allah says in Surah Al-Qiyamah, ironically enough, the name of the surah, is Al-Qiyamah, resurrection, the day of resurrection. It's number 75 and the ayah is number 9. Allah says, وَجُمِعَ الشَّمْسُ وَالْقَمَرُ, and the sun and the moon will be joined together. Because why? The container, the heavens no longer holds them apart. They don't, the sun, the moon no longer run on an orbit. So what they do? They crash against each other. And that is, that collision will cause both the sun and the moon to explode, to go in billions of pieces. But for us, I don't know what's wrong with these sheikhs. Of course, when you go to the books of hadith narratives and things like that, they tell you that a Jewish man came to the messenger of Allah and asked him, messenger of Allah, look, a Jewish man who doesn't believe in the messenger goes to the messenger and asks him about things that happen on judgment day that only believers believe in. Don't you see like the irony in this? But anyhow, this Jewish man who goes to a prophet and asks him, and he tells him, where will the people be the day when the earth will be changed into another earth, i.e. when Allah creates the new earth and when Allah creates the new heaven, where will the people be? The messenger of Allah says, and I want you to pay attention. They say that the messenger of Allah answered, they shall be in total darkness away from the bridge. The Jewish man is telling the messenger, where will the people be the day the earth is changed into another earth, i.e. in between the two earths when they turn into complete extension. The man is asking, when this earth is destroyed and the other earth has not been yet created, where will the people be now? But Mr. Hadith tells him, oh, they will be in total darkness away from bridge. What are you on, messenger of Allah? The earth has been destroyed and the other earth has not been created. We're talking about the now. But this hadith is in Al-Bukhari, and they are away from a bridge. I don't know what bridge is this. Yet somehow this stupid thing is part of our beliefs. If you don't believe in it, they will tell you are a disbeliever. And then they will tell you the sun will be brought a mile above your head or an arm length, even though the Quran, if the Quran, the book of the Quran, would talk, he will get thirsty in saying, there is no sun, there is no sun. Stop that, it's no sun, there is no sun. What sun are you on about? There is no sun. Allah said there is no sun. But people don't wanna listen to that. But that is the problem that we are facing today. This hadith narrative says that the sun, not it will be brought to torture people, to make them pay for their sins, to cause them to suffer by causing them to drown in their own sweat. And I find this extremely difficult to believe. How can the sweat level change from a person over a person? Let's assume like this, yeah? You have committed 10 sins and I committed a billion sins. How is my sweat gonna level up since we all are together? We're not in separate rooms and then your sweat is contained in that room. I would understand. But we're all in a crowd. How is the sweat for one gets higher, the other one lower, the other one is drowned? How is that heaven? It doesn't happen like this. If two people, as I said, are standing near each other, how will the sweat of one reach their neck and the other one reach their ankle? How is that possible? Also on Judgment Day, we don't need oxygen to survive. Oxygen is a necessity of today. On Judgment Day, we don't need oxygen. And we don't, it's so many things, we don't need them. We don't fall sick. There is no bacteria on Judgment Day. We will be given a new body, and that new body will have different characteristics that will adjust it and adapt it to the new life, not the life we have today. So if one is drowned in their sweat, I don't care much, because they'll be given a new body. Oh, my head is giving me the other thing, the other question that we should ask. Why would Allah cause the sun to come close? Haven't people paid enough in their graves, assuming that there is a punishment of the grave, as they say? If somebody has been punished in the grave, if someone lived 60 years and they sinned 30 years, all right? Then, and they in the grave, they say thousands of years punished. Where is the fairness of Allah to punish Fir'aun? He lived 60 years. Let's give him 60 years. Now it's been over 7,000 years since he's been dead. If the punishment of the grave is true, then for 60 years, Mr. Fir'aun is 7,000 years and he's punished. And then on Judgment Day, on top of all that punishment, he gets the sun. And then after that, he gets hellfire. Where's the justice of Allah? So, if Allah was to cause the sun to come close, and people have already paid enough in the graves, why would Allah punish the people before accountability? Allah has stated in the Quran that punishment will only take place after accountability. And this is why Allah says, so as for those whose scale is heavy with good deeds, they will have a pleasant life in paradise. But as for those whose balance of good deeds is extreme, is light, well, guess what? They will have a great punishment in hellfire. And Allah will not punish people until and unless He held them accountable. So now we go back to the sun. Since the sun is going to be a tool of punishment, will it happen before Allah holds us accountable or after? Before, it doesn't work. After, it doesn't work either. When will this event again take place, as I said? Look at this, what Allah says in Al-Quran. Okay, I think I stop here and I carry on the next one, so that at 42 minutes it gives us enough time. So I will stop here and I will carry on the next one about when will this event take place, about the sun and things like that. Yeah. Again, this is your brother Abdus Salam, and we are discussing, debating, negating, exposing the lie behind the seven categories that are or will be shaded on Judgment Day, when there is no other shade but the shade of Allah. Of course, all this is a lie, but we need to know. Okay, Allah, assalamu alaikum, and after the next part number 2.